All right, and we have gone live today, definitely for the first time. There was absolutely not an earlier attempt where OBS crashed so hard it necessitated restarting Windows, which needed to do updates, which took like half an hour. Anyways, hello, and thank you for joining us for Super Robot Sundays here on Sound Goblin Gaming as we continue our playthrough of SD Gundam G Generation Crossrays with the Gundam 00 storyline here. As we continue through that, I am, as always, Bograt.
I am the Krampus.
I'm still Shiv.
I'm Undergrain.
And I'm Vincent, for certainly the first time. Okay, so continuing with the story of 00, we hope.
Even more unified, as opposed to oddly more unified.
Okay, I would like to point out, the HRL has secretly invested in the creation of super soldiers. Soma Perez showed up and was like, "Hi, I'm Soma Perez," and immediately the person she was talking to was like, "Oh, you're one of those super soldiers, huh?" They're bad at secrets.
Yes, they are.
Designer babies.
Designer babies, we will fight for your side. Designer babies, our genetics are modified.
Bravo.
So I kind of wonder how long it's going to take for sci-fi to get beyond the period of magical genetics.
Never.
Probably, I know. Previously focused on a zero-sum game of their own creation because they're idiots.
Well, I do like the general concept, not necessarily in Gundam, but just in general in fiction of, oh, there's these three powers, and they've generally through skullduggery and Cold War and stuff have been locked in, you know, basically the same state for X amount of time, and then this radical power comes in and changes things. That's kind of interesting to see in fiction.
It's actually, in this one, I can give this more of a pass than usual. This is kind of a copy-paste of the more or less great power theory of politics, where there's basically, just to really simplify this one, they basically divided it into the U.S. sphere, the European sphere, and the Russia-China, we're really hand-waving sphere.
Yep.
The Russia is technically Asian sphere.
Yeah. The We show three countries that don't actually get along and
remotely
and hate each other into one block. Don't ask questions.
Maybe it's just based on mutual hatred of the other two sides.
No.
Look.
Because here's the thing you have to realize. Two of the three, sure, you could argue. Russia and China, not too fond of the West. India doesn't actually give a shit about us one way or the other.
No. India is the definition of neutral, and as a matter of fact,
India's like, we've got 1 billion of our own fucking people to worry about. We're not concerned with whatever you dipshits are doing.
Fair enough. On a long list of things I'm not an expert on, geopolitics is pretty low on that chart.
I mean, granted, India has a pretty poor view of the British for very justifiable
reasons. For very
reasons.
Understandable reasons, yes.
But, like, even then, modern India doesn't care. Like,
no, they are neutral-ish on Russia for the most part, mm-hmm. in the sense that they're a resource hub, basically, and they hate China.
Yeah.
And China and Russia don't actually get along as much as you may think.
No. They are extremely different types of communists, by which I mean neither of them is actually communist. Anyway.
Even back during the communist era. And post-communist era, yeah, they still don't get along. To the point where they nearly fought each other several times during the communist era. And Southeast Asia hates China with a passion.
And itself, and everyone else, and...
Yes. Vietnam, comparatively, likes the United States way more than China.
Mm-hmm.
Granted, it helps that the most recent war they fought was with China, so not us.
Yeah, quite literally, I feel like anytime you see something where it's like, yeah, the like anytime you see, you know, a sci-fi thing where it is, like, there's some sort of, like, Southeast Asian alliance or whatever, and it is an alliance that involves both India and China, I genuinely feel it's like somebody once heard the term Indochina and went, oh, that must mean there's some sort of, like, regional, like, compatibility. That it's like, no, that's not what that is. Jesus fucking Christ.
A, they don't really like each other. B, they're separated by probably some of the most difficult terrain in existence for the most part. These cultures are neither have nothing in common and don't get along with each other, really.
Yes.
But yeah, the unbelievability of that aside, the actual, like, portrayal of great power politics in here is actually a lot better than they usually do, and it's not like the lazy, okay, we're going to encircle everything and make it into a singular world nation for season one. And even season two, it kind of, and in general, they actually note the, like, flaws and general issues that come up. Via this theory, i.e., not everyone really wants to be thrown into the sphere of influence of random jackass country 1, 2, or 3.
Yeah.
Which inevitably causes conflict, strife, and problems.
And even in this one, even if it's not handled the best, they do still raise the idea of there are plenty of countries that aren't part of the three great powers that are still doing their own things.
Yeah. And even when they try to petition the great powers for things, there's conflict in general, like the Middle Eastern nation, the fantasy Middle Eastern nation that I can't remember the name of. Maria Ishmael's nation.
Yeah.
Lock on Stratos, the closest thing to an adult in the room.
Yeah, kind of. He's also kind of the least invested in Celestial Being.
Yeah. Which, granted, Celestial Being seems like kind of a hard sell in general. This is almost reflecting who their Gundam pilots are as well, so...
There's that boy, he keeps calling himself a Gundam.
Listen, just because the protagonist of our series is significantly less interesting Sasuke Sagara.
Effectively, yes.
Yeah. Have we had a series that's had both Setsuna and Sosuke in Super Overpowers?
Yes. They're literally in the last SRW game we played.
Yeah.
To be fair, I wasn't actually part of that one.
Yeah.
So I didn't pay that much attention.
Yeah, no, the FMP and 00 are absolutely in multiple different SRW games at this point together.
Do they ever have an ellipsis off?
No, Sosuke actually talks.
Yeah.
Yeah. There was an ellipsis off between Hiro Yui and Setsuna.
Yes. Oh, okay. Because in one of the Game Boy, I don't know if it was GBA? I know in one of the other ones, there is an ellipsis off between Hiro and Sosuke.
Not surprised. The ellipsis off is usually a joke involved whenever any of those three come into play with each other.
Yeah, the thing that's of importance is that the FMP stuff that was in the previous game we played is much later FMP, so Sosuke has stopped doing that shit at that point.
Yeah, he's a more developed
ish, because it did still have Gowron and Gates. It basically
but it pulled them forward is the thing. It's like Gowron was alive way past storyline wise where Gowron dies in the actual FMP.
What are you talking about? It's not dead.
Probably had a lamp driver installed that bad.
I mean, even in the books, if I remember correctly, they bring up the point that they didn't find a body, even though they also brought the point of there wouldn't have been a body.
I mean, I wouldn't expect them to find a body the first time. It was a suit that blew up in the middle of the Pacific Ocean.
No, I was referring to the third book.
The bed.
Oh, the bed?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
where there was a bomb directly underneath this hospital bed, yes. Yeah, there's not a body after that.
And he was already basically a cripple from being inside of an exploding AS in the middle of the ocean.
Yeah.
Also, it's entirely possible that at some point Sosuke and Setsuna were off in a corner somewhere ellipsising at each other, but they were being drowned out by the idiocy of fucking Cross Ange being spouted at us.
It'd also just be doing it over at Discord.
Fucking...
...... ......
we should do that sometime.
Hiro Yui is typing...
Meanwhile, in the mess hall, wow, I think I figured out a new culture to use to make yogurt. That new culture is Dragoonium.
Oh, God, no.
And that is actually Gatorade. Oh, no, the yogurt's attacking us.
I think I'm more fine with it being Gatorade than Dragoonium.
They're the same thing.
I'm aware.
Because everything is Dragoonium.
No, everything is Gatorade.
No, it's the explicitly the other way around in the game, which is what pisses me off. Fuck you. Get your cross and shit out of my good robot animes.
All right, I've got some bad news. We're halfway through this game leading to the next game.
I don't have to play the next game, and honestly, I can just mercilessly mock cross and the significantly large amount of time it's going to be on screen in the next game since it's a primary storyline.
So, who's for a marathon of Cross Ange?
No one.
Oh, we'll do it.
I think I'm just going to use ChatGPT and have it come up with insults for each of the characters. For every cutscene Cross Ange is involved in.
I think that's too much effort.
Lazy.
I think it's thankfully like 25 episodes.
Yes, it is fairly short. But I custom crafted each of the insults I gave for the teacher in Danganronpa. Thank you very much.
Yeah, but that's more effort than I want to put in for Cross Ange. For the first time, I found something at the dignity level of ChatGPT.
Based on how quickly we got through Seed, I mean, realistically, Cross Ange is going to be like 2 nights.
Yeah.
Two terrible nights.
I mean, we got through Destiny, and I don't think this is going to be that bad.
I again emphasize, you guys have fun with that. I'm fucking out. I'll be off on the side watching one of the other series from X that's, like, good.
I'll eventually get to that, too.
I will intentionally make a point of being in the Discord with you guys while you're watching Cross Ange and just be like watching Machine Hero Wataru or something. Buddy Complex.
So one thing you don't really get from this game that you do get from the anime and is kind of surprising is how actually good the subplot with Sergei and Soma Perez actually is.
Yeah, they don't spend a whole lot of time over here in the HRDL with the way that the scenarios are laid out and the way the cutscenes are.
It is one of the highlights, and Sergei is one of the best characters in first season 00.
Yeah. Which, again, doesn't come across as well in this game, understandably so, because there are things this does well enough with storytelling, which is battles, and things it doesn't, which is character interactions, because here's some text box before the battle.
I understand the way they did 00, but I could also see a kind of reverse 00 where Sergei is our main character and we learn about the weird terrorists who are attacking the world.
So in general, that's actually kind of the thing about 00. If it wasn't for the amount of time we actually spend with the crew of the Ptolemaeus, you could literally reverse the protagonist without issue.
Yeah.
Like, at all. Like, the only real villains in Season 1 are Alejandro, the Trinity team, and Ali.
Oh, hold on. Patrick Colasar is showing up. I need to... My boy!
I'm also surprised at how well Colasar does his job of being a somewhat joke character that happens to just survive. Mm-hmm. And is unusually charming at it for being.
Yeah, he walks a very fine line between being a goofball, being kind of endearing, and not being a shithead, which is a rare triple for a Gundam series. You don't usually get all three in one.
All right, I've made my decision about what I will be watching while you guys are busy watching garbage. Like I said, I'm going to watch one of the good series involved in Super Robot X. I'm going to go through and watch Nadia Secret of Blue Water again.
Oh.
Because that's in X.
Well, I know which part of the Discord Hunter's going to be in.
So, yeah, I'm torn there because Nadia's really good.
Nadia's really good.
I haven't ever actually seen Nadia Secret of Blue Water.
And, it is...
It's a shame actually be in the cross.
It is, at this point, probably my second favorite thing that Hideaki Anno has ever done.
What's the first?
Shin Kamen Rider. Shin Kamen Rider is fucking amazing. Everybody go watch Shin Kamen Rider. Jesus Christ, Shin Kamen Rider rules.
Fair enough.
I'm sad that I had to miss that.
I mean, I didn't go see it in theaters. I just watched it online.
Yeah.
But, like, oh my god, Shin Kamen Rider is really fucking good, yo.
So we put all of our nuclear waste in this one facility in this one desert. Nothing will go wrong.
Oh, I know what this episode or this episode was. Yep.
Oh, sorry, not nuclear waste. Weaponized nuclear material.
Yep.
I'm also actually surprised that the restraint of the show did not actually use nuclear weapons in any capacity.
Yep.
It's weirdly not that common a thing in Gundam series. Like, obviously, in Seed Destiny, that whole universe, it's kind of a whole major plot point about the whole, like, well, we created a thing to basically stop nuclear weapons from working, and then part of the MacGuffin of the series is, well, we made a device that stops the device that stops nuclear weapons, so now we're going to use nuclear weapons, but, like... Even within UC, it's like a thing where, like, it honestly comes, like, it's part of the backstory of UC Gundam, but really only comes up, like, once or twice in actual major plot capacity.
It's the backstory, it's Operation Stardust.
It's Operation Stardust, and like, in 8th MS team specifically, there's the whole subversion of it, of like, oh, we're using power bombs. Definitely not nuclear bombs.
Yeah.
Certainly not.
And like that, other than that, it's just kind of a background thing. It never even really, like, pretty much. I mean, part of the reason for the Antarctic Treaty is because everybody was like, "Oh, those are really fucked up. We should probably stop."
It's like, offensively speaking, these are too good at their job.
Well, it was partially offensively speaking, they're too good of their, at their job, and also we just realized just exactly how little of humanity is left at this point. We probably shouldn't use weapons that could potentially fuck that up even worse.
Yeah.
Because, like, with the colony drop of Operation British and the, like, after effects of that impact, if I remember correctly, like, whole human population within the Earth sphere by the end of the 1 year war was just over 1 billion. Like, they really fucked humanity.
Yeah.
Yeah, if I remember correctly, like, the very opening narration says that over 2/3 of humanity is gone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And again, a lot of that was from the initial impact, but also, like, they do go into the whole, like, it did create sort of a brief artificial ice age.
Yeah. Ah, yes, their plans to capture the Gundams via, what if we just send everything at them?
Eventually we'll wear them out, right?
I mean, there's like 4 suits. We have like 1,000 troops. What they didn't count on is Celestial Beam bringing backups from completely different timelines and worlds.
Let's put.
Dying Slev appears a lot in Veda's calculations. Does anyone know what that means?
We're dinosaurs.
That's good. What's the real secret objective?
Like, Christ, I'm pretty sure the G-Self Perfect could do that on its own.
No, because it'd run out of energy. That's
I am serious. I am seriously considering moving the G-Self Perfect to the raid group, by the way.
Just to get the energy regen every round.
Yeah, I think I remember basically keeping it there on purpose precisely for that reason. Yeah, in the maps that just have tons and tons of fodder, there's no such thing as enough energy, even when you're using, like, the lightest weapons.
Especially if they're just gonna, you know, keep throwing themselves at you.
They're more than happy to keep throwing themselves at you, unless there's a traitor nearby.
Please stop killing yourself on my sword.
No, please keep killing yourself on my sword. I want to get done with this battle. That's basically what it comes down to.
That's fair.
We have the united forces of 3 different nations all doing their best imitations of Leos. By the way, of all the scenarios that give you ludonarrative dissonance, this is probably going to be the top one. Okay, we'll actually survive that.
Yeah. I mean, again, these are the base level 00 suits. They're not extremely powerful by any means.
It has an extreme limit on its range.
No, you won't.
No, oh, victory tastes an awful lot like my own blood.
Al, the wind blow style of fighting. I am bleeding. Be the victor.
I mean, that makes sense, being on Sergei.
That's 11 to 6, doesn't it?
Yep.
Yeah.
I mean, still.
Yeah.
That, even with limit 6, that is 30,000 damage I just did in one attack spread across multiple units, so. Still absolutely up there among the most effective things I could do with that turn.
Yes, especially since there are suits that don't actually one-shot other suits when you attack them.
Yes.
Yep. Not among them is Barbados Rex, because it's Barbados Lucas Rex. But
yeah.
So not used to that having such short range.
I mean,
it's because I put an Awakened Pilot in. That's
yes.
I mean, we got the money, we can make Harry awaken. I wouldn't recommend it, but we could.
Oh, we have worse ideas.
Oh, yes, I'm aware.
And while you are technically correct in that we have the money and we could make Harry awaken, I refuse to add awaken to characters that don't naturally gain awaken.
Yeah, no, I understand.
It's a worthless endeavor, and honestly, we don't have that much money.
Yeah, stats aren't that cheap. Especially when you're going from 0 to 999 or something.
Yeah, it's like, let's put it this way. We are just under, like, 4 million capital, I think, at the moment.
Yeah.
I did start this game with roughly 12.
Yeah.
And then gave Jameel 999 Awaken. And later Bellry. Actually, did I boost Bellry? I think I was thinking about it, but I don't think I actually went through with it.
No, we gave him a bunch of skills. But
he's high enough to have new types lost power, so
it's 500 minimum. But
yeah, so you had to have done.
I did some boost boosting. Him a bit, but I don't think I put him all the way to 999.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah, because you wouldn't need to anyways. He doesn't have any awakened weapons.
He's at like 621. So yeah, I put him to 500 in order to trigger new types lost power, getting the extra press turn, but.
Yeah,
I did not go any further than that. And yeah, he doesn't have any awakened weapons on the G-Cell Perfect, so there's no point in making him 999.
Yeah.
And also, yes, a lot of that money did actually also go into putting a lot of truly ridiculous abilities on Jameel, because the amount it costs to add an ability to somebody is also based on like how many abilities they have.
And how good the ability is.
Yeah. The how good is, I think, a multiplier. The flat cost is determined by what essentially what ability slot it is you're filling.
Okay.
Television decided to temporarily blink. Oh, he can easily make that.
I was more just confirming that over here was where the other ones were.
Yep.
I had not actually looked over at this side of the map yet.
Go 5/9 sword.
Now that I've accomplished more than half the special goal in one turn.
Turn's not over yet, actually.
Yeah, one player turn.
Not counter with Harut.
No, it just takes way too much fucking energy.
Yeah, basically. You must have been 18, 18, or what, like 86?
Something like that, yeah. Takes so much energy and is completely useless to use against these guys.
Considering anything he does will kill them.
Cool. Good to know that literally the Vulcans on the Kamar Svidar will kill these guys.
Yeah, I knew that already. Pretty much, or assumed that already.
Doesn't always. Sometimes they'll survive the Vulcans.
More resilient things, yeah. Vulcans on the Kamar Svidar used to get an unusually large amount of kills. Granted, I had extreme range specialists in there, so that's kind of a deceptive metric. So their true strategy: run everyone out of energy by sheer volume.
So 38 kills on the first round.
Clearly they're hoping our troops have a pre-programmed kill limit.
Okay, yeah, so even the toughest fodder on this battlefield will die to the Vulcans.
Well, I mean, he's also supercharged now, so he's super critting automatically. Like, that's
the other thing, yeah.
Nah, he wasn't before that, though. Like, but that is not anything to discount, because super crits do make a huge difference.
Yeah. Oh, the red guns. Send it backwards, I guess. They can't attack what they can't get to.
Yep, pretty much.
Thank you.
in 8 minutes.
How fast this game goes, 5 hours might not actually be an anchor sometimes. Even then, that's still a bit of an exaggeration. Okay, now we need to send in Team Trinity to save the Gundam Meisters that I plan on disposing of and are of no use to me right now. Wait. This is extremely reckless. Seriously, why didn't you guys just leave?
Yeah, so about those counts, it turns out there were actually like another 16 there. I don't know. And a warship, like...
In a retro of events, they actually removed things from the field.
They knew better.
Let's remove all units so we can spawn 50 more units.
And this is the part of the Warhammer game where you're doing the math and you're like, ah, okay, there's no way we can win. We can, you know, stop 2 turns. I'm just going to take my models here.
I think if the AI was doing the math, we would set up our units and then they would just concede.
Pretty much.
How intriguing. The only winning move is not to play.
You really are screwed up.
Oh no, they spawned some aliens. Yes, you can.
Oh no, his feet are stuck to the floor.
And some flags. You know, the worst part is I know they have absolutely nothing interesting or challenging they could spawn, even if we're just using the Gundams. They are kind of hamstrung by the plot at the moment. Enemies. What could it be? Oh.
Wow, you really do just call yourself that, huh?
Yes. Yes, she does. Behold, Soma Perez and, like, 7 pieces of independent walking a blade of armor.
Barbatos Lupus Rex is going to drive you into the desert like a super tent stake.
Destroy the spider tank.
I am Alia Sanchez, and I fight like crab.
I still want to figure out A, where he got the fucking crab legs, and B, The look on the engineer's face when he asked for crab legs for his enact.
It was okay, a special request. Imitation crab.
It's like, how the fuck would this be useful? And now we have our favorite feature, an alternate map.
I saw something over there. It's a cloud.
Yeah. I think everything's in the north.
Pretty much.
Well, on the... Glad to see they didn't spawn anything interesting. Oh, they skipped it. What are those, actually? Black model of some sort, I think.
Union flag, ground, heavy armor type, shell flag.
There's an unusually large amount of flags, and I have no
idea. They just highly specialize them, essentially.
Yeah. Which is weird, because they barely appear in the show. Like, AU and HRL forces are much more common in general as antagonists. You get, like, Graham and the flags. His flag team, basically.
Yep.
That's about it.
I think they specifically even point out, like, there's other better, like, technically better suits in the AU. It's just that Graham is so fond of the flag that he favors it over any other mobile suit.
Graham is fond of bad suits? You don't say.
I know, right?
Back onto the surfboard then.
Yeah, pretty much.
Terrain.
シアのセブンソードで目標を断ち切る。捕らえた。武力による戦争根絶、ガンダムがそれをなす。
I'm the Gundam.
Ore wa naru nda. Kondo koso Gundam ni.
So let me get this straight, Al. You want to install 6 spider legs with knives on the end on their mobile suit?
That's correct.
While they're hidden, can you make it look like I just put the bottom half of my enact in a flying bread box?
It's gonna approve by the budget department.
The surviving ones.
Right. Get right on it.
Valiant warrior, Grandmaker.
No matter who I'm up against, I'll press on.
Take that, unmanned flight system.
Did you see me fight that dangerous warrior? You fought the flight system. Don't tell anyone, please.
Look, they don't care if the things are manned.
That's not true. I, Patrick Collishauer, winner of 2,000 mock battles, would never just attack an unmanned transport.
Honestly, the only thing that would be funnier is if Graham had missed.
Sad thing is, in season one, Graham is actually a very good pilot.
I mean, he's always a good pilot. He's just effectively the equivalent of if Shar Aznable had said, no, instead of giving me that Zeong, how about you give me a Ford Fiesta?
Yeah.
I choose to pilot this. That's the garbage heap. I know.
What if I made it stronger? Strap a better engine onto it. Nothing else.
For 1,000.
It's more that it does energy and morale damage.
Yeah.
Is the real issue with that attack.
I mean, he's getting hit by counterattack, so he's not going to get the supercharged very quickly anyways. No. And okay, that's like the one unit where energy damage really doesn't matter.
Fair enough. Yeah, it is primarily uses a big fucking physical sword, so.
And it has a GN drive, so it actually regens as well. Yeah. So, in addition to being like an independent plot unit, so it has regen in general. That's how you don't lose the big stupid spider.
Yeah.
ここにいる。そんな義理はね。任務を完遂させてみせる。
Is your mission getting pounded into the ground by a giant hammer? So if so, mission accomplished. Actually, legitimately surprised to survive that.
I mean, I know, so
I wasn't halfway decent pilot.
Yeah, like, it actually has a decent amount of defense and health.
Thank you.
Wow, you really hate someone. That's completely unnecessary. You know it.
I mean, there's never going to be a situation where it is necessary, so. Hi, Patrick!
Not again!
Also, it's less terrorist and more war criminal at this point.
Bye. Overkill. No, really?
Those guys over there.
Joyce.
I mean, it is ostensibly the correct choice. It is not going to prevent her from being pounded into the desert like a tent stake next turn by the Barbados Lupus Rex.
I was referring to the Hellion to the side of the attack.
Yeah.
Hey, should actually be able to kill the Enact and not have to sit around
on this map just being like okay, so those will die off. So yeah, all that's left over here is
I think it's just Soma.
Yep.
Bye, Soma.
Hi. That pressure is called a huge mace caving your skull in.
Do 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 do.
Yeah, it's like 2K. As long as you don't miss, you're good.
Cannot miss.
まだ続けるつもりか。もらった。 ンダムマイスターの力だ。
All right, forgotten their stupid helmets.
Yes. Also, did we just enter a Mega Man X stage?
I know, the song actually rips.
Yes. Grown two, and it's 00 tradition of giving a bunch of awakened weapons to people who don't have the awakened stat at all.
We can now recruit Katie Mannigan and two crappy flag pilots.
Yes.
Okay, they didn't actually manage to blow up a traitor.
No. For the most part, you stayed on the traitors during that one, partially just because actually annoying to
there are a few of them got attacked. I just couldn't remember if they actually managed to get one down or not.
You tried.
You really did. Kind of sad in a way.
そしてガンダムマイスターの窮地に現れた真紅の粒子をまとう3機のガンダム。このベーダの計画にさえも存在しない機体の出現を事前に察知する。
Are the particles from the pseudo solar reactors red?
I mean, it gets explained.
I gotta explain what they are. It doesn't explain why they're red.
ソレスタルビーイング創設に関わったコーナー系一族の現当主。
Food color. Red is a food color.
Hello, I'm Alejandra Corner, and this is my twink manservant.
What's his name? Ribbons. Delightful.
コーナー系一族の悲願の信念を果たすべく、密かに行動し続けていた。さらにもう一人の役者が存在する。アレハンドロの従者として付き従うリボンズという名の青年。彼の存在があればこそ。
Sure, he's evil, but in a delightful, puckish way. I keep him around for laughs.
自ら存在を秘匿しながらも今日に至った。
リボンズ、承知しています。このまま次の段階への移行を進めてまいります。すべてはあなたの王手のままに。アレハンドロ様、
voice does not belong coming out of that character.
そうさ、主役はこの私だ。
アレハンドロとリボンズ、監視者という役回りを逸脱し独自の活動を始めた2人の動きにより、ベーダの計画には明らかなねじれが生じていく。
Whatever the hell Beta's plan actually was,
コーナー家が数世代にわたり待ち続けた
This is never explained.
もう間もなく訪れようとしていた。
Did my phone go?
今、崇高な理念に隠れし野望
が、
その本性をあらわにする。
Regardless, Vince is the only one visibly able to read chat. What's the person saying?
Oh. Let's see, I'm doing mission 2 of Wings. Do you guys have Genesis? I was wondering, do you have YouTube? Did you see my comment? also, sorry.
Yeah, sorry. I'm like 12 feet away across the room from the screen and effectively wearing sunglasses today. So normally if I had my regular glasses on, I could actually read the chat from here. But the blue tint makes them fucked up.
To answer some of those, yes, we have a YouTube with Sound Goblin Gaming. Yes, we've played Genesis. The entirety of it's on that, even though it has like a 2-year break in the middle.
Yeah, we were doing Genesis in person over here, and then COVID happened, and so we put a stop to that and played a whole bunch of definitely games. We swapped over to doing visual novel style stuff, so we played through basically the entirety of Danganronpa and the entirety of the Zero Escape series in between there, but then recently resumed and finished Genesis.
And then Super Robot Wars X, and then we started...
V. X is the next one.
X is the next one, okay.
Our current plan for Super Robot Sundays is we finish this up, we're going to go on to Super Robot Wars X. Once Super Robot Wars X is done, we're going to be doing G-Gen Overworld, actually taking sort of a step backward, because it's the one before Genesis, even though I actually like it more just because of the insanity of the scenarios in it. Then after Overworld, we're going to do Super Robot Wars 30, because we already did T to finish out the VXT trilogy, and then go on to 30, and then once 30 is done, we'll do something. There'll either be a Super Robot Wars game that's released by then, another actual G-Gen game that isn't Eternal, or we can go back and play some of the older Super Robot Wars games that are also quite fun.
Or we'll build our own Super Robot Wars games with blackjack and hookers.
I mean, at some point, we will do a Vince's Day and Super Robot Sundays crossover and just play the Toho SRW games.
Yeah, probably at some point.
They're quite good, and like I think the first like three have been translated.
It's sort of.
They're playably translated.
They're playably translated, yeah. I know at the very least one and two are. I don't remember on three, and I think there were, because there was basically a collection that has graphical updates, I think they might have been waiting on a full translation of that. But last time I checked. And regardless, that will be a while. So
yeah, we've got time before we get there.
Yeah.
Yeah, Igloo is interesting just because of all the dumb stuff that shows up in Igloo, and it's like, okay, sure, strap a satellite dick laser to a, you know, underwater suit and have it dive through atmosphere, I guess. Go for it.
Go nuts.
Yes, Wing, accurate to the series, is a giant slog of combat that spams suits at you for pretty much all of its missions and cross race.
Special GN particles that cause cancer.
It's the food coloring.
Red dye number three. No. And if you ever want to check out our archives, there is the link for our YouTube channel. As mentioned, we've done G-Gen Genesis. We've done a couple of Super Robot Wars games at this point on there, both T and V. We've also done a lot of other stuff. We've done pretty much the entire Kingdom Hearts series. At least all the stuff that you can actually post on YouTube without getting your account banned. We've done all kinds of other stuff. Remember the Danganronpa and Zero Escape games. We've done all sorts of weird strategy games from China.
All
just
right.
One. I think.
About the French Revolution.
Yes.
We've done some Pokemon games in various sorts, randomizers, fan games, etc. Well, thank you. We appreciate the sub on YouTube. It's really just a stream archive, so we don't really have it post anything original to there. But yeah, we've got a fairly extensive backlog at this point, I think. God, it must be 5, maybe 6 years ago now that we started posting the King's Quest Let's Plays.
Yeah, I think just about.
At some point, we'll finish editing and post the rest of the series.
Oh, 4 is a slog.
4 is an absolute slog, and I do not blame you for that being just like the point of like, I can't do this anymore. Such a shame, too, because slogging through 4 is what lets you get to 5 and 6, which are definitely high points of the series.
I forget. For 3, did we ever put in real-time boat trip?
Yes, we did the April Fool's video, which was literally the inverse. It was fast-forwarding through everything we didn't fast-forward through in the actual episode, and then leaving the fast-forwarded stuff at normal speed.
Yes.
It is still roughly as long as the actual episode. Because that game makes you wait on a boat for like 25 fucking minutes.
For curiosity's sake, that was 5 years ago.
We posted 5 years ago. Staff. Yeah. Okay. Paying attention, they didn't touch them.
Their suits are better than yours. Especially you, I send knives out in random directions that do nothing.
We might do Battle Alliance. I don't know. Again, as you may have heard earlier, we've kind of got a pretty stacked schedule at this point already kind of planned. As far as we've got basically the next 3 games for Super Robot Sundays in lockdown, which all told means probably until sometime next year. But Battle Alliance is definitely a possibility. We might even do some GBO2 stuff at some point, since that's on Steam now.
Oh yeah, I need to migrate my account.
GBO2?
Gundam Battle Battle Operation 2. It's a third-person action shooter squad game, kind of.
Okay.
But, like, less in the Overwatch sense, which is Gundam Evolution, and more in the, like, more kind of tactical, almost Armored Core or Virtual On style.
Okay.
I believe they have started getting some units from AUs.
Yes, there are a few. Hey, thank you for the follow.
Ah, yes, the annual testing of our follow.
Follow.
I don't think we got every unit in Genesis.
No. God, no. We got a fair number of them, but we definitely did not do the like grinding necessary to get full catalog. We're likewise not going to be doing the same here. Like, we have like 80% unlocked here, but
it's actually a lot easier to get full catalog simply because of the set and forget.
The dispatch missions.
But there's a few suits that are just beat this with. Yeah, no, I'm done.
Yeah, the special quest unlocks are really annoying. Yeah. For Overworld, as a preparatory thing, I do actually have my personal file, which has almost 100% catalog completion. The only stuff I don't have yet is the stuff unlocked through the like sort of post-game challenge mode. But that was more so that we can have that record, because the whereas Genesis and Crossrays both have really good resources out there and really good information and all that, the only resource I have regarding Overworld stuff is a admittedly extremely thorough Japanese wiki page, which I am therefore running through Google Translate and using the decent translation from Google Translate, as well as my own just kind of personal knowledge of kind of all things Gundam, to figure out what the fuck they're talking about with some of these suit names that end up translated. So I kind of went from that and then played it myself and sort of got, you know, a bunch of information and stuff, and was able to figure out what I needed to do to unlock everything.
Yeah. In my own, Bogret is not bothering trying to get every special quest out of preference, mostly. I did, in my own personal playthrough of Crossrays, do basically every special quest minus two. One, because the game lied to me, and the other because it, which is in the second mission of Awakening of the Trailblazer, which is utter nonsense.
Oh boy.
So there's not really a solid wiki I use for Genesis in this game. There's a really good set of Google spreadsheets. If you give me a second, I can get you the links for those. So that's the one for Genesis. And then that is the one I use for Crossrays. And those are decently thorough. The Crossrays one is missing some info, but has, as far as I can tell, the missing info is maybe some of like the quest stuff. But all the actual suits are in there and how to get them and whatnot. So those are really good resources for these two games that I utilize. And then, like I said, for everything else, I'm working off of a Japanese wiki that is run through Google Translate in an attempt to know what the hell it's talking about.
Yes, these could only be constructed on Jupiter. Wait.
We've talked about this before. Jupiter exists as a MacGuffin more than a planet in all Gundam series. Something's weird going on. Weird's going on. Where did it come from? Jupiter. Oh, fine, whatever. But yeah, between those two spreadsheets, I basically kind of go through there, parse information out that I'm looking for, and figure out, do my own work, sort of planning development routes to get the suits that I want. For this particular game for Crossrays, we did a whole thing where basically each of us chose a pilot and suit we wanted to have fielded as part of our primary team. And so for some of those were pretty easy. Some of those I had to do a lot of work planning out routing to do stuff, because like Krampus chose as his pilot Graham Aker, and the only Graham Aker that's unlockable, well, the good Graham Aker that's unlockable outside of actual like progress through the story, is only accessible by unlocking every suit Graham Aker pilots in 00.
Which, considering there are roughly 400,000 variants of the flag, I think, or something.
Yeah, so
the pilots, half of them.
Yeah. All told, I want to say it was something like 9 or 10 suits I had to unlock. Like, it's not super hard once you get to one of them, because they all work in a development chain off of each other. You know, as would make sense, because they're all kind of Grandmaker suits. But getting into the actual, like, line of Grandmaker custom suits is what took a lot of work, because that was, like, that in and of itself was, like, a 3 or 4 step jump from any of the stuff you have access to by default. I think I had to go from, like, an AU Hellion into a flag, into the flag custom, and that was the first, like, Graham suit. And then from there, it was all of his stuff, and then all the Mr. Bushido suits. Likewise, for a while there, we were running Ali Al-Sachez as one of our pilots, and getting him unlocked again was a very similar idea, where I had to go through and get all the, get like 2 or 3 of his suits unlocked. But those were significantly easier to get to, because I already kind of had some of that stuff.
Yeah.
Amusingly, the throne line actually leads into the Arch Gundam, so.
I mean, that makes sense.
Yeah.
No one is impressed by you blowing up a flag. Shame, he destroyed an entire university.
Maybe if you're good on the way, we can blow up a wedding or something.
McDonald's. Shut up, Nana.
We have more civilians to murder.
Not gonna have the breakfast menu after too long.
Meaning we've been hacked. No, that happens all the time, actually. Turns out when you're using a 200-year-old operating system...
Can't hide secrets from the future with math. it is why we regularly and frequently upgrade encryption protocols to the next, like, highest factor for, like, how complicated the encryption algorithm is.
Yeah.
Because we literally have children's toys now that have enough computing power to break encryption from 10 years ago.
Yep. I certainly know nothing more about these throne things. As if these pilots were genetically engineered from ribbons or something. Yes, we will certainly stop war with violence. Wait.
I mean, it kind of did work briefly. Celestial Bean's actions were effective enough to cause the three major powers to unite together in an operation to attempt to capture the Gundams. So they stopped fighting each other very briefly.
Yeah, the thing is, Celestial Bean was a lot more nuanced and at least cared about civilian casualties to some extent. When it came to the Ptolemaeus.
Can't make an omelet without breaking a few skulls. If children didn't want to be murdered by Gundams, they should learn to run faster.
By the way.
Oops, was that the trigger?
Oh no, how careless of you, Nina. I can't believe you've done something like that.
This certainly won't have plot ramifications in the future.
Thank you.
Nearly figured out how OGN drives work. All right, so if I mix some ketchup and some mustard.
Open it up and there's three robotic arms working a bop it.
エクシア、目標を捕捉。3機のガンダムスローネを紛争補助対象と断定し、武力介入を開始する。エクシア、目標を駆逐する。
No, the Ptolemaeus are idealists acting under the vague orders of a random supercomputer. You guys are sociopaths.
Your machines can't be Gundams. Well, why not? What's the qualifier of being a Gundam? Well, you're not.
In this universe, the qualifier of being a Gundam is having the title Gundam.
Being called a Gundam, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, before the Thrones, the qualifier... you could almost make an argument that the qualifier was actually being able to run off of a solar reactor. That's about it.
Yeah. That's the thing, though. That's never actually like established as this is what defines it as a Gundam. They're like, well, that's a Gundam. Well, why do you say that? Because it's printed on the fucking forehead.
Also, what the hell is a Gundam?
Yeah,
which is the undefined thing of it.
Yeah, it's like, don't get me wrong. As stupid as Gundanium alloy is, it's at least a legitimate thing of like, okay, if it is a suit made from Gundanium alloy, that makes it a Gundam. That's a definitional thing.
Yeah. Similarly, the Xenos is a running joke and will work better in a less serious series.
But it's like, at least you can justify, like, okay, if it has one of these particular style of OSs, it's a Gundam. This is just like, what makes a Gundam in 00? Well, I don't know. We fucking called it a Gundam.
Any two Trinities at the same time. Oh, right, they're actually a raid group, that's how you call them in this one. Hypothetically, doesn't really matter.
Why not? They're piloting Gundams.
Yes, but they are douchebags.
being a douchebag disqualified you from being a Gundameister, half the Gundameisters wouldn't be Gundameisters.
Listen, just because it's hypocritic doesn't mean it's not true.
To be fair, when you are a self-admitted terrorist organization, you fall into ideological conflicts pretty easily.
Oh, at the drop of a hat on this one. And in all seriousness, this man shouldn't be near a butter knife, let alone Gundam.
Ah, seven butter knives. Sorry, the 5-9 butter knives.
No tub of butter is safe. Yeah, that would probably actually kill them both.
Why not?
Neither of them are in it currently?
No.
Yeah, that should probably do it.
Him all the time.
No, he fights on the same battlefield and they both try to ignore each other's existence.
Fair. You're not fit to have the title Gundam Meister. We taught a Haro to hate and gave it a cat girl body, and that's a Gundam Meister.
More cutscene. They're actually on speaking terms somehow.
God willing. You can tell by the angry look on my face. Just gonna do that anyways.
Yes. lock on being probably the most likely to follow something resembling an order, but yeah, it's still pretty much going to do whatever he wants.
I mean, it'll change the world in a very small, centralized way where the thrones leave a crater as they impact the planet.
Behold my Gundam in a Gundam.
Magical bullshit hacking powers.
Behold, the test system, my ability to turn, or trial system, my ability to turn your Gundams off. Ha 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 ha.
Thought you said they weren't Gundams.
Shush you.
Checkmate, motherfucker.
Also, this is Tieria, technically, so I don't think he even cares.
Yeah, even Tieria was saying shit like, you're not worthy to be called Gundam Meisters. It's like, they're piloting Gundams, they're Gundam Meisters. It's literally what the fucking term means.
No, no, no. Well, not worthy is not the same thing as you are not. And the trial system has stopped working. Should have conducted more trials. Ah, through the power, magical power of backstory.
Your name is stupid.
Ish. I mean, on the scale of this show, it's not terrible. It's not Sergei Smirnov for the Russian. Could have been like Patrick Leprechaun or part of the fine tradition of Celestial Bean to recruit from terrorist organizations.
Well, then clearly I'm not responsible because I'm here.
I'm just going to guess they were on vacation because this is actually extra confusing to me.
Who fucking knows, man?
So there was a Middle Eastern suicide bomber in an Ireland that is still going through the troubles. I will say there is a convenient amount of deserted desert or deserted tropical islands in the 00 universe for them to land on.
No, they were not on vacation. They were just on a family outing when the KPSA launched an attack on the recreational area that the land these were at.
Why?
I don't know.
Other than being Ali Al Sanchez and he has an unusual sense of sense for setting up random plot nonsense. Or we were to put it in better terms, he's just a walking plot device.
And yeah, it was just straight up in Ireland. Which was apparently in retaliation for fossil fuel embargoes.
Okay, there's no world in which Ireland, of all places, is going to even be a major player in a European alliance. Mostly just out of lack of care of the Irish. I don't think they... If they're in a European alliance, they're still just kind of over there.
You're going to prevent us from getting fossil fuels? Well, we're going to blow up Ireland. Are we supposed to care? do Do they think that the rest of Europe has ever given a shit about Ireland? Have they opened a history book?
England. England cares about Ireland. That's about it.
In the sense of, those uppity motherfuckers better shut up or we'll kick their shit in again.
Then they're right there, so it's kind of...
Like... I have no real, frankly, personal feelings about Ireland one way or another, but they are not a major political factor in any way, shape, or form. And frankly, even if the KPSA did pull off some sort of bombing in Ireland, people would probably just assume it was the IRA.
Yeah. I mean, I assume they claim credit for it or something. Yeah. But yeah, no. Bombing from a Middle Eastern terrorist group in Ireland? It's...
A Middle Eastern terrorist group in Ireland to protest fossil fuel embargoes.
Look, have you looked on a map recently? The Middle East and Ireland are like 2.5 feet away. And that's on a big map.
I got out my ruler. They were totally like 5 inches apart. Surprised they don't get hit more often.
Also, just the logistics of this. You are actually trying to smuggle explosives through the entirety of the rest of Europe, which is going to have a bunch of other soft targets of equal law. Really lacks flights to Ireland? That's the only thing I can think of.
I'm more surprised that there's that heavy of a dependence on fossil fuels 200 years in the future when this takes place.
Considering we're currently in the early phases of phasing them out.
Yeah. And, like, most of the technology we see canonically in this series isn't operating off of fossil fuels. Like, yeah, they don't all have solar reactors. That's the whole, like, big revolutionary thing for the Gundams, but it's like...
But they still have
the mobile suits aren't running a fucking internal combustion engine.
No, they're basically... I think they're basically battery powered.
Yeah.
The Ireland bombing is a 2020 or 2297.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
270 some odd years from now. And a fossil fuel embargo? Are there fossil fuels left?
Yes. Also the fact they have to actually build. Granted, it's kind of a past sci-fi, not knowing what the future holds type of thing to some extent.
This was like 10 years ago.
I know, but I'm going to give it a little bit of
15-ish.
Yeah. Maybe a little bit of a...
I'm going to assume that the Gundam and mobile suits aren't using like internal combustion engines.
No, but I mean like...
They have space elevators!
That's actually the thing I was going to comment on. The space elevators is where they get the energy.
Yeah.
That's not necessary at all.
Yeah, but it's like...
Because it's all solar.
Yeah, but it's also just like... That's the thing, is like the argument of like, oh, past sci-fi, not knowing. It's like, you can make that argument for like, neuromancer not accounting for like, wireless technology, sure. You cannot tell me, in the early 2000s, we were already well on the way to developing green energy and working towards eliminating reliance on fossil fuels. This is not a, like, oh, there is no way in hell anyone could ever have predicted this technology.
Yeah. I mean, our current limitations are other than, like, sheer resource cost, storage and transportation of energy.
But it's like, those are things that are going to be fixed. Like, there's no way you don't.
And if you're setting your series 200, like, nearly 300 years in the future, you know, the series came out. I'm pretty sure you can hand wave. Oh, yeah, they figured out some energy problems in the 300 years between now and then. yeah. in the world where they have giant mobile suits and space elevators.
I mean, it is, to kind of address what Vince was bringing up, there is an issue with, and it's a, like, it's a commonly reflected thing of, like, you know, sci-fi stuff that in the future, things like that. There's always a common thing, and, like, granted, it's less so applicable to technology because you can usually try and extrapolate technological development, although sometimes there are just curveballs that come out of nowhere that you could never see coming, i.e. wireless technology for internet connection, things like that.
Yeah.
But, like, the big one that people always point out is anytime there's music in any sort of future sci-fi thing, it's like that just, like, it sounds like the music of today because it can't not, you know, like,
yeah,
it's, you cannot. Whereas when you compare, like, modern music to music from 200 years ago, it's almost like unidentifiable as the same thing, you know? And so it's just like, it's a very, there is a difficulty in creating future art or science, frankly, just based on the fact of, like, we can't create what we don't know. So
that,
like,
that's not true. Just make any sort of music sounding thing that's based on Pachelbel's canon. You've got, like, a 95% chance you're gonna react in the future.
Well, no, we do have an establishment.
Just do a four chord song.
As Brian David Gilbert discovered, just make ska. You know, it's the music of the post-apocalypse, because you know, you got to go around and, like, you got to have an instrument that's easily transportable and could, like, you know, be decently carryable and not really have to. So you're not gonna have, you know, pianos or things like that. You gotta have something that's lightweight, pretty easy to maintain overall. So, you know, like, I don't know, like a horn or a guitar. The lyrics should reflect the kinds of things that you're familiar with. So, you know, you're a scavenger. You're out there, you know, finding stuff and picking it up. You got to pick it up. 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 Burr, burr, burr. Oh, God damn it. I just made ska again. But, yeah, it is just kind of those things. It's like, it's part of why I do not like the definitional characteristic of quote-unquote hard sci-fi, where people are like, oh, this is, like, scientifically realistic. It's like, we didn't know that germs were a thing 200 years ago.
Yeah.
Like, you can't be like, oh, 500 years in the future, there's no possible way they're going to discover this thing that is, like, you know, like...
Yeah,
and that's unrealistic. It's like, it's unrealistic based on the information we have now. The information we have now is different than the information we had 15 fucking years ago. Like,
yeah. No, it's more, the better definition of hard sci-fi is stuff that actually falls just more defined structure and logic within its own consistency at the very least.
That is a better definition, but that is not the definition that people use.
No, it is not. But yeah, trying to write a future world has the problem of it doesn't exist yet.
Yeah. But then you have, like, complete and obvious utter failings, like in this instance, where it's just like, no, we are not going to be heavily reliant on fossil fuels in 2297. We're just not.
Probably not going to be heavily reliant on fossil fuels in 2097.
Yeah, probably not. Yeah.
Also, these things have finally appeared. The GNXs, or Jinxes, as they're pronounced in the English dub. I like Jinx, actually.
Yeah, so, no, that's fine.
Okay with that.
As a side tangent to the future, it's hard to write about the future thing. It's fascinating to watch Star Trek deal with that, because on the one hand, Star Trek is so close to magic, it's frightening. Because they've just solved all the world's problems. They solved food.
It's a post-scarcity society. Yeah, post-scarcity
society, and they've got fancy technology everywhere. But on the other hand, whereas a lot of the other cultures in the universe are focused on improvement, performance, building new stuff,
right.
A lot of the Federation focuses on the past.
Well, it's even funnier in the perspective of Star Trek, because now we're starting to get series or movies or what have you that are effectively prequel or, like, time-based, taking place prior to the original series, but very clearly look much higher tech than the original series, just because our technology for filmmaking and special effects has increased so much that it's like, because we have like the one of the current Star Trek series, Brave New Worlds, which is explicitly a prequel to the next to the original series, because it's like Captain Pike and like Spock when he was still part of like the Vulcan Science Academy and all this stuff. And it's like, okay, but like the technology here looks way more high tech than the stuff that was in TOS. And it's like, obviously you get some suspension of disbelief. You just kind of go, yeah, okay, I get it. Like, whatever. But it is just really funny that they have to try and like sneak it in. And it's like, oh no, this is totally what transporter technology always looked like.
Although DS9 did go the extra mile when they were doing their Back in Time episode. They did actually, like...
Oh, yeah. They shot it...
the set.
Well, they remade the set. They actually shot those episodes on, like, older-style film, like, to give it the same, like, film grain effects and stuff that it would have had. Like, they definitely did, but, like, no, it is legitimately funny. Like, even something like First Contact, you know, the movie for the Next Generation movie where they literally go back in time to when humanity first encountered the Vulcans and became part of the United Federation of Planets and all that. And it's like, okay, but like some of the technology they're displaying there in past Earth is more advanced than the stuff they have in like the original series.
Yeah.
I mean, hell, talking about the, you know, I bring up like the Neuromancer wireless internet thing, even more recent than that, actually, Mega Man Battle Network. Because the original Mega Man Battle Network games literally came out before wireless was really at all a prevalent internet technology. So that's why literally you have to plug in your fucking PT into everything. And like later games, kind of a little bit after wireless became a thing, literally just like, sure, we have this thing that one side you plug into the PT and the other you plug into the other thing. And
you,
it's you like a radio.
You throw just like a shuriken into ports.
It's like a radio transmitter.
That doesn't explain why everything in the world plugs in it, but
yeah,
we'll allow it.
Whatever. That's.
I mean, I can understand.
Plug in the statue in the park.
I can understand some secure systems literally having no Wi-Fi capability built in because that'd be the point.
Cool. What about the bear statue in the park? What about your oven?
Well, clearly, those things are... Actually, your oven really shouldn't have Wi-Fi capabilities, but...
As evidence, the very first dungeon of the very first Mega Man Battle Network game. Oh no, a virus got into my oven. Now my house is burning down.
What about your friend from down the street's personal homepage, which for some reason has a back entrance into the dark web?
You should be reporting your friend to the FBI.
I was also going to say, how are we explaining the fact that in order to get through a firewall barrier in the net, you have to put out a fire in your actual house? And this takes down the firewall barrier.
This is what happens when the tall mass runs out of alcohol for Mr. Miragi.
I understand. Alert. Send the Meisters on a beer run.
I do not get an employment point here anywhere. And,
Now, the jinxes are way more enduring than the fodder we've been fighting. They're still not that enduring.
They're still fodder.
Yeah. They will stand up to the cursory glance from a stronger unit. There's like very little things in the game that will stand up to a burning finger after there's a decent amount of levels on someone with a good melee stat.
Yeah.
The trace system is nonsense. Yeah, that is well on the lower end of damage of what this thing is capable of.
Yeah. No.
I mean, there are guns on that thing, but no. Try to pretend they don't exist. You have an entire ship on the other map?
Huh? No, the...
Oh, no, it's down here.
Oh, it's okay. Over here. Yeah. Both the spawn points are on this map.
Ah, okay.
One day this will stop being funny. Today is not that day.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, it's the first version of it.
Yep.
It's not the second version of it.
Hi, Patrick. There's two ways you can view this. Either I'm clowning on him constantly, or I'm giving him the honor of a good death. I know which one of these two is true. Do you?
So, ironically, I could argue it's both. No, Ptolemais is not actually a ship.
You guys back off. Mask has got this.
I Hell, he's in the raid group. He actually regens.
Uh-huh. We've needed to do this for a while.
Yeah.
Single pilot in the Jinx. What the fuck did I do?
Best joke I've set up for this entire fucking playthrough, and it never stops being funny.
I'm fairly certain we didn't need to work together, but we'll take it.
There are multiple suits standing right there that joined in the attack that needed no help in any way, shape, or form.
Congratulations, baby. We've completed Operation Ragnarok.
Yep. That is, in fact, what the quest is called for doing a 9-member warship link up on a single target. I don't think they meant for you to do it to a grunt, but fuck them.
That's honestly usually what happens anyway for that one, because it's a fairly easy quest. I think it gives like a gold mod. It's actually,
I believe it is a gold mod, yes. this mission where there is literally no place that the Barbatos can actually get off of its SFS.
Yeah, it's
actually no. I think it might be space capable. Yeah, it's not air capable.
Yeah, it's space capable.
I mean, I'm not gonna have it get off here because it can't really get in range of anything. But
no, it'd be a waste of movement, basically.
That's right. It's not air capable. It is still wholly space capable.
Yeah. Yeah. Unless the train is sky or sea, can usually get off of a.
Yeah.
I think it's technically the same idea with the Camaras Madara. It's just that you rarely get off the Trider because you don't need to.
Yeah. Yeah, again, as we kind of mentioned last time when we were talking about this, very few things like fly in IBO.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of them have like sort of jump jet style stuff, but.
You just spawn 12 more Jinxes. No, not even that many. You guys have just been staying in the corner while they get worked at home. That's the actual problem with this, with this part of the series. Like, well, they're kind of in a bunch of bad scenarios and getting worked. Meanwhile, we come in with Murder Squad and just destroy everything.
Yeah, it's kind of those like, oh no, there's so many of them. We're being way too pressured. There's no way we can win. And it's like, not a single one of them has landed a hit yet. Send like 100 more dudes. It still wouldn't help.
They've lost like 70% of their starting forces. I'm pretty sure we've got this. It's even worse on the mission where it's like destroy 50 of them. There's only like 60-ish. It's
yeah. Like, I've been using the Vulcans on the Camaras because I don't need to do anything more.
Yes, that GN drive plot point that the show doesn't actually explain too well. So basically it takes about 20 years to make a proper solar reactor. The pseudo-solar reactors or Tau drives are a lot quicker to assemble, but have limited runtime, basically.
And, yeah.
Other than the thrown ones, they actually need an external startup as well. The thing about it is Celestial being made 5... period, and refused to make any more. Kind of on purpose. As they trust their pilots about as much as you think they would. I'll get into talking about the like Celestial being Gundam's proper more in the next series because it's actually a lot more appropriate there. Effectively, though, the O is Generation 1. Generation 2 exists. They're currently piloting Generation 3.
Yeah.
Marina. まだ生きている。生きているんだ。動け、エクシア。動いてくれ。ガンダム。
No. It's goddamn.
Oh, maybe that's how they came up with Gundam in this universe.
Huh? No, I have my phone. I just don't have the case part of it.
Everyone else's system is turned back on. Teria cannot find the on switch. We now resume the enemy's first turn. What did this poor UN soldier ever do to you?
He stepped. Did actually barely kill him.
Yeah, the Jinxes are actually like much more significant fodder.
Well, it's
they are still fodder.
It's less that and more that everything we have is boosting melee, so the ranged attacks don't get much boost.
There's that too, yeah.
You guys do know there's a Kamar's of Dar up there, right? It's not safe.
Related note of worship link ups, especially when you have some good suits, are really strong.
Yes.
That was only 4 suits.
Yep. 56.
Yep. Thank you.
in it.
Ah, they've almost succeeded at Operation Run the Thing Out of Energy.
Almost.
Decision. I will say the Jinxes actually have a really good range too.
Yeah. They've got the long barrel beam rifles.
Yeah. It's like if they made less annoying Virgos.
Yeah, just go being lazy and don't feel like manually moving over to the Mars.
Ah, Daryl.
Yep.
Oh, Also, one guy's brain in a jar.
Always forget that this thing has knee drills.
This thing has everything.
Yeah, no, in a series that already goes over the top on a lot.
A gun lance, rail gun, another gun, a sword, some shield bit arms, shield arms, knee drills.
Yeah, in a series where the Gundams particularly are already pretty over the fucking top, the Kamara's Vidar is extremely extra. All right, who's left?
That's a good question. Those three, okay.
Over here.
Look, are they? Hey, in raid group?
No. Actually, yes. Yes, Sven is part of raid.
Oh, what does he have for skills?
Nothing great, because he's got, like, one.
Okay, yeah, he's not very high level.
He's like, level four. We just got him.
Gotcha. I was hoping there was something that could make this move faster, but it has anti-G Anfield, which does nothing. As it turns out, in order to hack into Veda, you have to complete stages in Donkey Kong. The Trinities.
Oh boy. Yeah, that is actually what you get for doing the two of them at once.
Yeah.
Hey! 7% HP restoration per turn.
This is great if we ever got hit.
Yep. That being said, that's going to go ahead and do it for us today for Super Robot Sundays here at Sound Goblin Gaming. Sorry for the little bit of late start and technical difficulties we had there, but should be all set from here. Join us tomorrow for more Poke Mondays as we finish up our first sort of round of legendary hunting and then proceed more with the post-game story in Pokemon Infinite Fusion. Join us over on Hunter Green's channel on Tuesday. Some of us will be there where Hunter is going to be playing through more of the Final Fantasy II Pixel Remaster. Join us for Thursday as we continue to try to figure out what the fuck a Sorak is in Solasta, Crown of the Magister. And right back here next Sunday as we continue with 00 in SD Gundam G-Generation Crossrays. Until then, I've been Bograt.
I've been Chiv.
And I'm Vincent.
Krampus stepped away and Hunter's mic died partway through this. So they're still here, but not on mic at the moment.
They are here in spirit and physical body, certainly.
All right. Have a good one, everyone.
Yep. Goodbye.